Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Deep Dive. I'm here with Lexi Mayfield, who was one of the brains behind Rise of the Triad Ludicrous Edition. Lexi, how are you doing?
Doing okay. Yeah. Like you said, my name's Lexi Mayfield. I've been with Night Dive Studios for a couple of years now, and happy to be here.
All right. So can you just give me a little background on your role in the project, as well as sort of how you became involved with it?
Sure. So essentially, it came up during one of our stand-up meetings that Rise of the Triad was coming across our desk. And I kind of volunteered on the spot because that was one of those games. It's one of those games like Doom or Quake or one of those types of games where kid me would have loved to have worked on one of those projects and was Absolutely. Fascinated with those games Absolutely. As a kid. And it's like, now that I'm at a place that remasters old games, that's one of those projects that's like, oh, that would be really neat to be able to work on that.
Cool.
So
yeah, juicy one. So what makes this game so special to you?
Well, I mean, I do think that it is a large part of it is actually nostalgia because
that's fair.
When I was a kid, I was very much into the shareware scene of the mid-90s PC market. And I just remember loving to play the Apogee back catalog, the Epic Mega Games back catalog, all of those, and just random things that you would find on the internet. Or the early internet. And Rise of the Triad was one of those games I discovered. And it made such an impression on me because I had played Doom at that point. But Rise of the Triad seemed to me like it was the first time I could ever recall that I could actually get a sense of who the people were behind the game. They weren't just people. Names in the credits or anything.
Right.
You could read the Rise of the Triad FAQ and get an idea of, oh my gosh, there's all these clear in jokes to Office stuff and who people are. And they would just throw things in just for the heck of it because, you know, hey, let's have a missile that splits into multiple other missiles. Let's have a baseball bat that you can charge up because why not? We're just trying to cram as much cool stuff into one game as possible. And that really made an impression on me. Like it was one of those things. It's like, man, it would be really neat to be a game developer one day.
That's
so
cool. One of the cornerstone moments of, you know, your early childhood or childhood where you were like, oh, this could be a thing. You know, Rise of the Triad was, you know, not taking it. It was a serious game, but it wasn't taking itself too seriously. Can I kind of elaborate on that a little bit?
Well, yeah, it was. There were just little tidbits of that all throughout the code. Most games would have maybe four weapons. Doom's
right.
eight or nine. Just a series of weapons that you could grab and. It seemed, but Rise of the Triad would just cram five or six missile weapons in,
right.
All at increasing like silliness. Like,
yeah.
Oh, hey, let's have a flame wall that the missile hits the ground and it creates flames, and if they touch somebody, they just collapse into a pile of bones with the little xylophone thing where it would just go like, and it was
definitely had some absurdity to it.
Yeah, it was just absurd, and there were lots of little references to pop culture that I didn't get at the time. There was, like, one of the bosses was named after a Red Dwarf character, Sebastian Doyle Crist was apparently a Red Dwarf reference.
I did not know that.
But it just had all these little bits and pieces. For example, there was a command line parameter called dope fish, where if you put in dope fish at the command line, instead of the normal Apogee logo crawl, it would just show Scott's mystical head and and bounce it around the screen while turning everything into belches. It would change all of the level names to silly names as a result. So yeah, it was just it was just endless, and especially there was a widely circulated, frequently asked questions file that you could download that was often very easily accessible from places that you could get right, and you could just download the FAQ and read into here's the 50 different cheat codes, and here are all the here's where they came from, here's where the references came from.
Cool.
And like, and we decided to throw in a secret area that did nothing but crash the game, but the crashing the game we did would show a really silly screen with a picture drawing of the wall leaving the area with "I'm free" on it. It's like, it's, you just got the feeling that the people who are making it were just having tons of fun.
That's awesome. So, yeah, that's really cool. Chock full of weird references and little things, like even when you break the game, you know, there's something to look at, there's something to see. Has that one's own style and development style and coding style, has did that influence you in any way in your style and how you work and develop a game?
I think it kind of did, especially on Rise of the Triad itself. I really tried to kind of keep that irreverent tone in the additions that we made, but just in other games, I really appreciate places where you can kind of sneak a reference in, or make an oblique reference to something, or even just throw in something extra because, hey, wouldn't it be cool if you could do XYZ? And I really do try to get some of those in when I contribute, contribute to a project. Doesn't always get in, but it's, back in those days, you could just do, and when it was your money on the line, you could just afford to do that, and it was now it's a little bit more buttoned up, which can be good and can be also bad in some cases, but you know, it's worked out for us.
I like that. So, thanks for sharing that. Speaking of things that you have to cut, what's some of the cut content that was in Rise of the Triad? Was there stuff that you added or subtracted in this new version, the remaster of the game?
So there were actually a number of cut actors in the game. So a lot of the enemies in the game were originally slated to have alternate versions, where it would randomly drop an alternate version of a enemy in just randomly. And the feature had to be cut because it would not, all those extra textures wouldn't necessarily fit in 4 megabytes of RAM or whatever the target. I remember running it on my 4 megabyte machine, and I'm very glad that they made that accommodation. They did actually reuse some of that alternate actor code to implement the violent slider. It actually included a little violent slider so you could turn off some of the blood and some of the grosser stuff if you wanted. So some of that functionally did end up getting reused. Cool. But they just couldn't fit all of those extra textures into such a small memory space. And we actually got access to betas that had these actors in the data files, and we had to go through and clean them up. An artist had to go through and clean up all of the enemies in an old school shooter game like this. Yep. It's not like today where you have models and rigging and stuff like that. There's generally like a walk cycle that's, in this case, it's like 4 or 5 frames, and you have to do it from 8 different sides, and there were just so many frames of animation to rip through and clean up. But honestly, just being able to see all of those alternate actors in the game again was just amazing, because it's like, awesome. Because like it was like, the FAQ was describing this and how it was cut, and it would be really neat to see this. And there were even single frames of the cut actors in the ending of the retail game. So it was really nice to be able to change those credits from the cut actor to putting them with the rest of the cast.
Cool. So that's really interesting. Yeah, I don't like. been so long since I played the original. I don't remember that credit scene. I might have not even made to the credit scene as a kid. We'll see.
Also, in the shareware version of the game, they had a completely different credit scene.
No kidding.
It was a credit scene where it basically gave you an intermission. It was like, are you going to be ready for the full game? Purchase it today. And then if you sat at the screen, it would basically tell you, hey, why aren't you just pressing a button to get past this screen? And it would start making fun of you. And it So chalk another one up for the silliness. There's always more with this game.
That's cool. What about the music? What did you folks do with the music on this one? Was there any changes or let's talk about that. I'll let you spit some on the music.
Oh my gosh. So the music in this game is from Apogee and id alumni, Bobby Prince and Lee Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
And it's probably some of the best music to ever come out for classic PC games, at least any that use the MIDI format that a lot of mid-90s PC games did. It was some of the best there was at the time. Like, in some ways, I actually prefer the soundtrack to Doom, which might be blasphemous, but I mean, you have so many amazing tracks. I Choose the Stairs, Havana Smooth, Going Down the Fast Way, Suck This. Oh my gosh. Like, there, if you haven't heard, if the audience hasn't listened to the MIDI soundtrack of Rise of the Triad, please do yourself a favor. Find that stuff on YouTube, or just play, buy the game and play and listen to it in, while playing. It's some of the best of the era. And amazing. What we ended up doing is that we actually deliver the music three ways. We have it being played over a general, over like a Windows 95, Windows 98 general MIDI kind of way.
Yeah,
it's actually an a Roland SC55 rendition of it, which is kind of like, there used to be literal boxes that you could buy that you could hook up to your computer, and it would play the MIDI music with some really, really nice samples.
Yeah,
but we deliver it three ways. We have the really nice sounding MIDI. We also have a soundtrack in there that tries to mimic the way it would have sounded on a Sound Blaster 16 or some other piece of kit that most people would have had back in the day. And then we managed to get the soundtrack to the Rise of the Triad 2013 remake.
Oh, nice.
We managed to get that soundtrack, and you can just pick whichever one you want from the options screen. Because I mean, the music is the remix is good, the original versions of good. It's all just good stuff, just good DOS music.
Yeah, I have such an affinity for that DOS music. It's just like, I don't know what it is. It's just stuck in the gray matter of my brain where it just does it for me. You would just have that on loop in your head as you played through these levels and played through these games. It's just
And even if you haven't played Rise of the Triad proper, if you've played any amount of custom content for a game like Doom or Duke Nukem 3D, I guarantee you at some point you have played a custom level that uses Rise of the Triad music. You just might not have known it yet.
The next thing I wanted to go into was a bit of the challenges with, the code and what you had to do about that. So yeah, tell me about what roadblocks you hit or what challenges you had with trying to fix up this code for release.
So Rise of the Triad is running on a very much evolved version of the Wolfenstein 3D engine. Mm-hmm. I mean, the game was originally Wolfenstein 2, Rise of the Triad, but they just decided to, but when they couldn't get the rights to Wolfenstein for a sequel, they just decided to call it Rise of the Triad. So this was, this is a Wolfenstein engine. And so if you've ever worked on like Doom from a source port, and especially if you've worked on Rise of Wolfenstein 3D, obviously, mm-hmm. you'll see a lot of similarities. But also with all of the extra features that they had added to the code base, they were twisting this code into doing a lot of things that maybe the Wolfenstein 3D engine was never really designed to do. And so the code was, the code tended to crash a little bit more than one might have hoped. And also, we didn't, and also the code was never got a, never was ported to a lot of places like Doom. Within a couple, within a year or two, Doom was on the Jaguar, then the Sega 32X, then later we got PlayStation Doom, Saturn Doom. We got all these other ports of Doom. Rise of the Triad never really got that. So all you really had was the DOS port. And then later on, they did release the source code to it later on. The game was just never really designed to be played on a console, and a lot of and so there was just a lot of code to go in and make accessible to a gamepad and make sure it didn't break with a gamepad. And also there were some subsystems that just had to be replaced, like the menu system. The old menu system was like 320 by 200. We needed to replace it with something that was modern, it looked like the old one, but could also be localized and have other languages attached to it. So yeah, there was just a lot of things that you had. There was a lot of things that you had to add, and then you also had to make sure it didn't crash. On DOS, things were a little bit less picky because memory protection wasn't that big of a thing in DOS, and so even if you did crash, who cares? You just press the big reset button.
Yeah.
Right next to the turbo button, but you just press the big reset button and get your computer back. Well, you can't really do that on the consoles, and you wouldn't want that to happen on the consoles. And oh, by the way, we wanted to be able to ship an entire new episode of new content. We wanted to make sure all of the old content worked to the best of its ability. We wanted to ship a level editor. We wanted to make sure all of the cheats were accessible. It's like, how are you going to fit 50 odd cheats onto a controller? It's, you need to come up with something different, and you need to invent a multiplayer that can work over the internet, because multiplayer in those days was assumed that you were on a local area network and were dealing with latencies of the guy sitting next to me on the computer next to me. It's
right.
So the code base was just pretty old, and a lot of it needed to be cleaned up and reworked to be accommodating of controllers and just not crash. I think I spent months running the game under a memory analyzer called Address Sanitizer. Anytime I could just be playing the game normally, and all of a sudden my game would crash, and it'd point out, hey, this specific thing is wrong, and I'd have to go in and drop everything, go in and fix it, because there were a lot of bugs that only reared their head sometimes or in very specific situations. And it was just kind of in attrition in a way, you had to just work through it. And I think that what we ended up shipping was, it was probably one of the most stable, Rise of the Triad ports out there, honestly. So
amazing. Amazing. That's awesome. Yeah. I'm just learning about things like maintenance cost of code and whether or not to do it from scratch or not, and that sort of thing. So it seems like, you put in the time, the work, and that's awesome that you're, you know, on the other end now, and you can look back and see, it's like, oh, we shipped something pretty, pretty amazing and got it to a state that, you know, everyone can enjoy.
I was really pleased with how people reacted to the game, because it in our in the various Discord servers on Steam. And I'll never forget the number one thing I was looking forward to was what Civi 11, the YouTuber, would say about the game, because up until that point, Civi had done two YouTube videos on Rise of the Triad, and it was clear he had a very deep appreciation for the game. And I was actually referring to his videos when I was developing the game, making sure that we tried to tackle as many of the pain points of his game of that he had with the game as possible. And that was the thing that I was looking forward to the most, and cool. seeing his glowing reaction to it was just the most gratifying thing. I think the mainstream publications treated us pretty well, but it was really good, gratifying to see the real fans of Rise of the Triad enjoy what we had brought to the table so much, and just having new people who had maybe never played the game before, just having them hop in and experiencing the same. I mean, we're in 2023, 2024 these yeah. days, so it's not going to have the same effect, but maybe just help. That was kind of my goal. I wanted people to see what I saw in this game and yeah. make sure that was kept front and center in this port. So
that's amazing. I love that. That's such a good story. And that's Civi 11.
Yeah, Civi 11. He's an amazing YouTuber, and covers a lot of old contemporary games, and covers some of our remasters as well.
Nice. Awesome. What's your favorite weapon in Rise of the Triad?
Ooh, I think it's gotta be the firebomb. And the firebomb, the thing about the firebomb is that it has rocket jumping. It is rocket jumping that predates Quake, and you cool. need to rocket jump in order to get the best ending of the game.
Nice.
And so, yeah, I just think that is incredible that the developers were forward thinking enough to have rocket jumping in the game years before Quake came out. And yeah, that I think they cool. are something special about
Firebomb.
That.
Firebomb. I love that. Okay. Well, then that leads me to the next quick question. What's the most ludicrous moment that you've encountered in the game?
I think that the most ludicrous moment in the game is killing the nasty metallic enforcer,
yeah.
the enemy. That thing just will not go down. That thing will just swarm you with missiles, and it just takes forever to get down. It's probably the hardest boss in the game. In some cases, it actually pops up as a recurring gotcha moment in some of the more difficult joke levels that were included with Extreme Rise of the Triad expansion. There's at least one or two parts of that thing where you'll just open the wrong door and there's an enemy right there because you chose poorly and now it's time to die.
I love it. You've obviously poured your heart and soul into this and care about the game very much. Was there something you wanted to highlight, but like something you wanted to shout out that you're really proud of?
So I think that when I was talking earlier about how I was and how I wanted to kind of bring forward some of that silliness and make sure mm-hmm. it was front and center.
Yeah.
I wanted to make sure that as many of the old jokes were accessible as possible. So I had to go through. I wanted to make sure that the dope fish mode was in there, because you used to be able to access it through a command line parameter, and they don't have those on a Nintendo Switch. So
exactly.
So there's this menu that I called the cheat menu, and it's originally called a secret menu. And you go there and you type in one of the cheat codes. It'll congratulate you for remembering one of the cheat codes, and then it will basically give you all of these extra toys to play with. It will allow you to enable the dope fish mode. It will allow you to the game actually would change slightly during the various holidays. You can access all of the holiday specific Easter eggs in that menu, and you can actually keep track of the secret codes that you've unlocked, because I mean, expecting people to remember 50 different cheat codes is a little bit much. It's back in the old days where instead of like having it in the game, you're expected to go on game FAQs or whatever else. I introduced a way of unlocking cheat codes into the game itself to make sure that everybody would gradually get access to these cheat codes, and instead of having to memorize 50 different button combinations, just here's a button and you can just use whatever cheat you want from a menu turn them on, turn them off, do whatever you want. I just am so glad that all of that, awesome. All of that extra secret content was kept for the remaster.
Very cool. That's amazing. And, yeah, I love that. I love that. Yeah. Even though that stuff was hidden back in the day and now you're bringing it to the forefront and being able to make it so accessible that, yeah, a new player can go in there and be like, what, like, why is this Christmas theme in here and stuff like that. So, amazing stuff. Well, I don't want to take up too much more of your time. Was there anything else that you would like to touch on with regards to Rise of the Triad?
So I just wanted to put a particular emphasis on not only did we bring back some of the older content, mm-hmm. but we also brought in our own new content. So essentially, some of the new content we added was we decided to add an entire new episode to the game from some of the people in our company that could make levels, and also from some community members. And it was just so neat to see what the engine could get away with and what you could do inside this really hacked up version of Wolfenstein 3D. We also updated the renderer. It now runs at resolutions that are much, much higher than it ever had any business running at, while still able to be maintaining a playable frame rate on less powerful hardware. But we also added things like we updated the lighting model. So all of the fire sticks have more realistic highlights and lighting. Nice. That's sourced from the fire stick instead of just highlighting the entire box or something like that. And we also put a lot of work into the level editor on PC. We editing a level in Rise of the Triad. There were a lot of level editors, but a lot of them were designed for Windows, for older version of Windows, or maybe weren't the most stable things in the world, or just were designed for DOS. We really wanted to bring up the standard of Rise of the Triad editors, where you could see what you were working on, you could press a button or two and immediately be into the game, and then go back and make changes, upload things to the Steam Workshop. We really want, I think that's something we put a lot of time and effort into, and it's so amazing all of the extra stuff that we were that we crammed into this project. Honestly, yeah. it's sometimes I can't believe that we sometimes it's kind of unbelievable how much, I mean, because this game deserved it. This game was so underrated. It was compared to Doom, it was the kind of game that you would only know if you were really into the DOS shareware scene in the 90s, and it really I felt like it's spot in the limelight, and its accessibility especially is long overdue. I'm so glad we were able to bring this awesome game to modern audiences.
Yeah, and old fans. Yeah, absolutely. Like I like many others, grew up in that shareware age, and to see it in this state is pretty unbelievable, and to have folks like you working on it with, you know, coming from such a place of passion, and to do it such justice and add so much content in there, it's pretty amazing what you were able to do. So yeah, thank you again for your work on the game, and I wanted to thank you again just for coming and chatting and sharing your experience with the development of this thing. And yeah, I've just had such an awesome time chatting with you, so thank you again, Lexi.
No problem. Thank you so much for this conversation.